Hey, everybody. Welcome to this week's episode of Pensado's Place. I got to tell you, recently I signed up our whole team to the Grammys, and a lot of it has to do with our guest. You'll meet Harvey Mason Jr. in just a second. But first, we've been telling you a lot about the Pedal movie. It's brought to you by Reverb, a very cool thing. It's the story of the amazing role effects pedals have played in music. From Hendrix to Frampton, Stevie Wonder to Rolling Stones, and so many more. Bunch of interviews with engineers and people had to do with effects pedals, Steve I to Steve Albini, and a whole lot more. Great information, things that will entertain and teach you. Now, our man Dave is a guitar player, and I wanted to see what he thought. Let's go check him out and see what he thinks. DP?
Man, I loved it. There's just so much here for us engineers, producers, and musicians. I took a lot away, and I think everybody should watch this. Got some great information, Herb.
So catch the movie on iTunes, Google, or Vudu, or go to pedalmovie.com. Good stuff from Reverb. Thanks, Reverb. On your calendars now, mark Thursday, May 20th. The 1500 Sound Academy is hosting a free virtual event on creating beats with Outputs Arcade. Good stuff, cheat codes, learn how to make your beats better. Go to 1500sound.academy to register. And for us, hit us on our socials. You see them right there. And also do us a favor, like and subscribe. Always important to do that. That helps us grow and helps us be around. Now to our guest. Look, let me just say this to you really quick from Uncle Herb. The Grammys are way more than the show. They legislate on your behalf. They provide financial assistance. They educate. They connect people. They have job banks, talent banks. They celebrate the whole body of music from the 17-year-old newbie to the classic legend. There's every reason for you to be involved in the Grammys. And here's what's really cool about this guy. When we did this interview, he was the interim head. We are proud of him. He is one of us. When I first met him, he was the mix engineer for Rodney Jerkins way back in Jersey years ago. And now he is the newly elected CEO in place. Enjoy our conversation. This was before he was newly elected with Harvey Mason Jr.
Hey, buddy. How are you, Herb? Good to be here.
Man, I hit you immediately after the last Grammys because I was blown away. Now, as somebody where we may share some similarities, you know, we watch horse races and we're on boards and there's all the business stuff. But because everybody's taking a ratings hit, I just got a chance to enjoy. And I know for you, it can mean, you know, performance and funding and all kinds of stuff. But as an artistic endeavor, you smoked every other award show on. I literally was watching it with my lady and we said, you know what, let's replay it. And I haven't had that experience in 10 years. Tell us the challenges of putting on such a great show during COVID and what all that meant.
Well, first, thank you for saying that. I appreciate it. It was a major undertaking, as you can imagine. I mean, you're doing it with trying to put on this show and have guests and figure out how to make it safe, but still entertaining. So first off, I'll say we changed dates. We pushed back. We were right in the middle of kind of an uptick in cases around the end of January when the show was supposedly supposed to take place. So we pushed that back, which was, I think, the first smart move that the producers and the Academy and myself all made. I didn't feel like it was the right time to be having a show at the end of January. So we had certain protocols in place for COVID, making sure everyone was tested and everyone in the crew and staff and performers and musicians were all tested. That was another step that was very important. So we could make sure that we were able to invite people and make sure that we were able to put a great show on. And then the next thing we did, which I thought was, I think, successful or semi-successful, was to host the event in the round. So all the performers performed almost for each other. And so you saw a real community of artists and creators coming together to support and celebrate each other, which I thought was really unique. Right. And that was the idea of Ben Winston, our executive producer. It was incredible the way that he pulled it off. And I just think the tone and the energy of the show was so different. A little bit out of necessity because of COVID, but also just because think what we're doing as an academy is very different. The people we have doing things, a perfect example, Ben Winston coming in to produce his first show is somebody, it's all new and different. First time he's ever done our show. Wow. Obviously I'm in the leadership position, which is new and different. So we're trying to look at everything we're doing at the academy with fresh eyes and see how we can do things better, more productive, more entertaining, more service to the music community.
If you, talk to Ben, just high five Ben for me. As somebody who puts on an event, it was well done. Sorry, Dave, I stepped on you. Go ahead.
No problem. I jumped in early. I wanted to give you a compliment in the Academy because Music Cares is doing such great work, and I'd like to take a moment to challenge our audience to support that and to make sure it stays alive and stays funded, because I've got personal friends that have. One of which would have lost his eyesight if it weren't for Music Cares. And then the other thing that I'd love, there's three things I'd like to see, Harvey, so I'm going to get it off my chest now. Mm-hmm. One is I'd like to see us get more credits. And two, I'm a staunch supporter of music in schools. And without music in schools, it's going to be a little bit of a bleak future for music, because you learn how to listen, you learn how to play, you learn how to do all these things. And best of all, you become a fan because you're a practitioner of the art, Mm-hmm. And so I think the most important thing is that we all get together and find ways to buy instruments, folding chairs, give a little extra pay to teachers and stuff. So anyway, got that off my chest. Thanks, Harvey.
Well, it's perfect. You couldn't have teed it up any better, Dave. It was an exact segue to what I'd love to talk about, which is the Academy and what we actually do beyond the Grammys. Herb said he loved the show, which mm-hmm. I'm glad everyone liked it. But that Thank show you. Generates the income for the Academy. That's mm-hmm. how we earn all the money. And we're not for profit. So the organization does not make money just to make money and get rich. It makes right. money so that we can put it back into the music community. And it does three things, and you hit them. It's almost like I scripted this for you, or you scripted it for me. So Music Cares is our philanthropic arm that is really a safety net for music people who need help. Somebody who's facing drug addiction or trying to recover from that, or doesn't have money for bills or needs medical attention. That's what Music Cares does. And during COVID, Music Cares has given away over $30 million to music people who've really needed help, whether they lost their job or just had issues. And so exactly the reason you mentioned is exactly why Music Cares is there, to make sure we're looking out for the music community. Second thing that we do really well is education. And we are putting instruments in school. Yeah. We are going in and teaching in underserved communities that don't have music programs. We're making sure that the next generation of music creators is actually being exposed, as you said, to different types of music and understanding, it all doesn't just come from a computer. It comes from these instruments, and you learn how to play and you learn how to write and how to sing and create. Yeah. And so that's something that we do really well. And then the third thing is advocacy. Making sure that we can continue to make a living, making sure that we can monetize the art that we create, and making sure that this is a viable career for people. Otherwise, all the great and talented musicians and artists and creators are going to go do something else because they're like, well, I love making music. I love writing music, but I'm not able to make a living. So the advocacy is a big part of what we do. And we're fighting for a new legislation in DC, making sure things are happening for the creative community. And that's why I love the Recording Academy. We do take some heat for the show. Somebody doesn't win, somebody doesn't get nominated, somebody's mad, we cut off their speech. I get all that. I've been on the show, I've been snubbed before, I felt like I should have won and I didn't. But I remind people that it's not just about the awards. The awards are a means to an end to make sure that we're able to help our music community.
That's right.
So
that's right. Well said. I gotta tell you, Harv, the clearly the impetus and the focus of the Academy with Music Cares, with education. I'm heavily involved on the education side on a number of fronts, and I'm impressed by how even down the line, people at the high school level and other levels are committed to making education happening. And they're seeing what we always say, which is audio is the one thing that is in every discipline. You can't do the other disciplines without audio. So it's given us a renewed attention. But here's the other reality. The Academy under your leadership is more progressive the reality of it, I can feel the shift. You know, I watch these kinds of things. Another organization that's like that, which I think interviewed you, is NAACP under Derek Johnson. It's a new thing. And my boy Kyle Bowser, who runs the Hollywood side, we talked about you actually, and the fact that they were engaged and knew. So, you know, we are good with criticism, but we also have to be good with credit, because you walked into something, there were roiling waters, you've had to, you know, balance those roiling waters. DEI is so huge. And it is super impressive that, oh, I'm sorry, Jesus. That's Beyonce calling. just a joke. So with that said, I think there's an advantage that somebody who is a accomplished music maker and understands what it's like to be a musician to head up the Academy. Do you think is that valid?
I think it's very valid. And I think it's given me a unique perspective and an opportunity to really make change that can impact our music community. You all know me. I've been on your show before. I'm a music person top to bottom through and through. Sir. And so when I look at anything, I'm approaching it from a creator standpoint or a musician standpoint. So I actually ran for chair of the board of trustees at the Academy, which is an elected position. And my platform, or if you would call it that, was really one of change and how can we upgrade? How can we improve? How do we look at everything we're doing at the Academy and see what we can do to make it better? And so I was elected on that platform. I think people at the Academy knew there was a lot of room for growth and transformation. So as chair, I started that. And then as interim president and CEO, I've had the last 14 or so months, I've had the opportunity and the ability to wear both hats. And it's really given me a unique space to really drive some cool change and some really, I think, much needed innovation at the Academy. And I feel really good about where we are. We always say, and I tell everyone, we have a lot of work to do. We've got a long ways to go, but we've come a long way in the last 12, 14 months. You spoke about a DEI, making sure we're representative and reflecting, you know, current and contemporary music in all genres, making sure that people are being listened to and we're being relevant and contemporary with everything that we're doing. So we've done so many different things over the last year, but you touched on a few of them. So thanks for recognizing and for the back pat.
Great.
Harvey, speaking of wearing hats, if you wore all your hats, it'd reach your ceiling. So, dude, I had to take a break reading your bio. I got tired. I almost couldn't get up. It just wore me out. I'm sure
too much. I know. Sorry.
Right.
Too much.
Well, the good part is that you look so good for having done so much, you know.
Well, I used to have a lot of hair and now just poof, gone.
Same here. I color mine, so I'd look like Santa if I was there. But to Dave's point, do you get a chance to still make music? Do you have any time?
Absolutely. I'm in the studio every night. You know, I go in, I have an office here that I work out of for the Academy stuff since we're all virtual. And then at the end of the day, I get in here and work, and we're still doing a ton of great projects, doing some records, doing a lot of film and TV. I'm not sure you know, but we have a film coming out this summer. I produced the Aretha Franklin film, Respect, starring Jennifer Hudson. So that's coming out in August. Very, very excited about that.
Yeah, man.
Of course, executive music produced that as well. But so I'm still hustling and grinding. And like Dave said, wearing multiple hats. And at the end of the night, 8 o'clock or so, I take off my Academy hat and try and jump in to do some creating. So I still love that. And that's what I'm looking forward to going back to when we hire a new CEO later this summer.
Well, let me just say this. I'm not sure we're going to allow a new CEO. I've been meeting with people privately, and we're going to kill off term limits and let you, and have you stay there, brother. So I'll give you an update on that later.
I would love it. Thank you, buddy.
So Harvey, when I was looking at your bio, I immediately wrote down the question, do you have any techniques for managing your time and how to be more efficient? I could use all of that. If I could take that away from this interview, I'd pay you heavily.
I love it. I love it. I try my best to be very organized with my time for obvious reasons, as you said, trying to get a lot of things done and trying to wear a lot of hats. But I start very early. That's the thing about my day. Usually starts about 6 a.m. and I spend the first hour of the day really planning and plotting and strategizing what I'm going to do that day. And I know that sounds like a lot. Seems like, wow, that's really boring and you're doing too much, Harvey. But I sit for the first hour and I just think about what I have to accomplish. I go through my schedule, my calendar, and really plan out what I want to accomplish in that day. And then starting 7-8 o'clock, we start doing phone calls, meetings, Zoom calls, emails. And it's really regimented. You know, every 30 minutes or so is accounted for. I try to keep all my meetings and phone calls under 30 minutes. I kind of believe that if you can't get it done in 30 minutes or you need to talk longer than that, something's not set up properly. So my staff and my team keeps most things for me to 30 minutes as far as meetings or phone calls. Obviously, you can't do that with sessions. But so I get through the day in an organized way and then try and make sure that time is blocked out to, you know, listen to a mix or to, you know, do an overdub on a part or record with a vocalist. And those things are just very blocked out. And then at the end of the day, when I'm being more creative, it gives me time to be a little less structured and just have that time to sit down at the piano and write or get on the computer and do some editing, things like that. But to me, it's really about having set strategy for the day, having specific goals on what you need to accomplish in that day, and then just executing it and sticking close to schedule.
You did it to me again, dude. I'm getting tired already.
You know, what's funny about, there's a big venture capitalist fund called Andreessen Horowitz up north. What the hell? Who is texting? Mark Andreessen calls it wandering. He builds into his daily schedule time to wander and just think, create. You know, when you're left brain, right brain, if you don't feed both of them, one of them suffers. Right. And it's really important to carve that in. I find I do that overnight, which is why people say, man, why are you sending me emails at 3 o'clock in the morning? Because that's when I can. So I completely get that. And I think it makes for that balance makes for better leadership because you're feeding all of yourself as opposed to just getting run down in one space. It's a critical
leadership. Yeah. The other thing is if you're not doing something you're passionate about, it's really hard to manage your time.
Yeah.
If you're just grinding something out that is not exciting, you're like, oh my gosh, I'm getting overwhelmed, but I wake up excited. I'm so into what I'm doing. I'm so just energized by the day. And when I look at what I'm trying to accomplish, that's exciting to me. So it's very easy to, you know, manage your time, to cram a lot of work in because I'm excited to go from one thing to the next, to the next, to the next. So I think that makes a big difference. Find something you love, find something that you care about and you just can't eat or breathe without. And I think you'll find it'll be a little easier to manage your time.
You know,
Thank you.
One of the indicators of an organization are the people. And there are just people inside Naris that I just like talking to. I don't even have to have a reason. Maureen Droney, obviously, Ivan, Kelly Purcell. Like, I could just keep on going down the list. And I think that good people stay with an organization because the organization feeds them. I think it's representative of their mission and their passion. And that wasn't always the case. That is something that is new. And as I watch, and I'm going to share with you off camera something that we're doing that I think will be applicable, but as I watch the DEI efforts and the approach, because you can approach that from a really broad place, which the Grammys has to, and then try to wrestle it to the ground. But the commitment to and the intellectual level of the people that are dealing with it is really refreshing for because we have to be concerned about it because the constituency we represent, which is pretty broad. And there's always a different factor when somebody who deals with exclusion and somebody who doesn't. You know, people, there's a word I like to talk about, bias. There's so many different kinds of biases and people don't sort of under, you can be explicit, it can be implicit. I say it can be complicit. And you guys are are tackling that as important things. Speak about those efforts.
Well, you touched on a key point for me. We talk a lot at the Academy, and our bias is a bias for action, the bias to make change and improvements. So everything I do, as we said, I wake up excited, and everything I do in my daily work is to try and think, how can we make a change? How can we do something better? You know, we did a complete reorganization of the Academy's senior staff. So when I arrived, there was, I think, 16 direct reports to the CEO. We reorganized and put verticals in place so that there are now 6 direct reports. And we brought in some new people, some new leaders. And one of those leaders was Valicia Butterfield Jones as our Chief Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Officer. She is actually the first diversity, equity, inclusion officer at a senior level in the music industry, which is amazing to think about. And since we've been hired, there have been 4 or 5 others brought on at the majors and other companies, and they all meet now and they talk every month, and they have a forum to share ideas and experiences and continue to build the DEI around the industry. So that's something I'm extremely proud of, and I think needs a lot more celebrating and attention, that work is being done by our industry. And, you know, there's a lot of room for improvement around that. So those people are doing that work, hopefully led by the great DE&I officers that are in place. But, you know, our bias for action goes much broader than just DE&I. It's how can we better serve the music community? And that's the thing that, you know, we got to keep at the front of mind. The Academy is here to help and serve the industry and music community. And that's why sometimes it can be frustrating in my position, because I know all the great people, like you mentioned. I know all the people that are so dedicated to serving the Academy and thereby serving the music community. And I know how deeply invested they are in their heart and their souls into helping music people, because they love music people. I see it. I walk around the building when we used to be in the office, and everyone's into music. Everybody has their favorite artist. Everybody's just in that culture of music. And so when I see the criticism that the Academy sometimes gets, and I'm by no means complaining, some of the criticism is valid and we deserve some, but when people start just singularly focusing on just the awards, it sometimes can become frustrating, because I know all the wonderful people that work at the Academy and all the incredible work and effort that goes into helping music people. And I talked about it on the show. I said, if you're upset about something, we want to hear about it. We want to work on it. We want to improve it. But we want you to come in and be involved in the Academy and help us. Because if you care about music and you care about music makers and the community of people that are passionate about making this art, then you'll help. Instead of tearing things down, you'll help, you'll bring positivity to this and important change and transformation. That's what I'm trying to do in my term here.
Yeah, I kind of got a little pissed off when I was reading your bio. I try to like you sometimes, but dude, what's up is a Grover Washington placement that you wrote when you were 8 years old. Everything else you've said to me today is irrelevant. I know you had great parents. I know your dad, you know, your dad was a gifted drummer. And is that the press exaggerating, or did you really get a Grover Washington placement at 8 years old?
I think I wrote the song when I was 8, and I think they might have recorded it when I was 9, but somewhere in that neighborhood for sure. I just grew up playing the piano. I was playing the piano my whole life. And I think I was 4 or 5 years old. My folks had a piano and they started teaching me about ear training. They'd play a note and I'd try and go plunk it out on the piano. And my dad, as you said, was a musician, you know, one of my favorite musicians.
Gifted musician.
And then my mom also was a musician. My
Absolutely.
Mom was a trombone, if you can believe that. And my folks met at New England Conservatory of Music. I was born, I think I was probably a little bit of an oopsie, but I was born while they were in college. And so I had musical genes coming from both sides. So when they moved to Los Angeles, when I was probably 1 year old, I was always musical. I was listening to music growing up around the studio with my dad, hearing my mom play and practice, hearing my dad practice. And so I started writing music really, really early. I was taking piano lessons, but I didn't like listening to all the classical stuff that they wanted me to play and practicing the scales. And so I ended up just writing music and using my ear. I did take piano lessons for 7 years, so I continued on and did some training, but I just always loved writing music. So one of the songs that I'd written, my dad heard, and he was going to a session. He was playing, you know, on a Grover record, and he said, "Man, I like this." And he played for Grover, and Grover heard it, and they cut it like the next day. And he came home and said, "Oh, we recorded your song. And I said, "Oh, cool." And I didn't know what that meant. You know, I was nine. Sure. And then I think I got a royalty check from the publishing, and I was like, "Oh, wow, this is great. I can buy a model airplane." So, music translates to making money. So definitely acknowledge that I was very lucky. I was in a position that a lot of people would not be in to have their music heard, but very thankful to have that experience.
But that's a segue into kind of a granular level that I think is important for our audience, is the reasons to join the Academy. You know, the idea of, and one of the most simple things, I think, I certainly did that with my career when I moved to LA from Kentucky, of all places, is you get exposed and get connected to people who are actually working in the space, and you can get advice and make relationships and network, let alone all the other umbrella things that the Grammys does. Do you agree with that for somebody thinking about joining?
Completely. I think the collaboration, just the camaraderie that happens around a chapter or a different event or something that's happening through the Academy is really important and really powerful, because you are meeting your peers. That's the thing about the Academy. It's made up of your peers. There's not press or labels or lawyers voting and judging this music. It's really your peers and your fellow creators. And I think the chance to interact and interface with them is definitely important and valuable. And I think being able to support, and it was a little bit like our show this year, right? Being able to support each other and being able to learn and grow and maybe collaborate with your fellow creators is definitely a value that I think the Academy brings and membership brings.
And as a real example, 4 or 5 years ago at one of our award shows, we got behind a musician who had an accident in Nashville, was paralyzed, didn't know if he's going to be able to come back. Mm-hmm. He now is walking without help, which is amazing. And Music Care stepped up with one phone call, paid his rent, helped with his hospital bills. There was no friction. It was absolutely as caring a thing I've ever seen. They got a call from a co-host of an internet show they had heard about, but we didn't know. It was immediate, man. And it says everything, particularly for a constituency that often doesn't get attention the same way, that gets, you know, their gig workers that get thrown to the side, and then, you know, they're just detritus on the road. So we can attest to the fact that the Grammys work in real fundamental ways that help your life and help sustain your life. We just recently lost a giant in Al Schmidt. And I know he was a proponent, and Maureen Droney wrote his book, and that kind of care extends in so many different ways that until you get involved with the Grammys, you don't know how many things there are past the show. It is truly the right organization, led by the right people. Moving forward, more stuff, more attacking the problems, dealing with things. What's on the horizon for you?
Academy wise, yeah, there's still a lot of work to do. We still have things we want to change, things we want to improve. Looking at the way we do our voting, looking at how we do our nominations, still staffing things that we're going to continue to work on. Other initiatives that I'm really passionate about, and also continuing to expand and figure out other ways for us to take music around the globe and take what we do around the world, and also chances to try and generate new revenue, because as I said, the revenue that we generate comes back into our community. And it doesn't have to be just to our members. The money doesn't go to our members. It goes to the entire industry. And as you said, with Music Cares, if you have an issue and you go to Music Cares, there's that money and a pile of resources there for anybody. You don't have to say, "Oh, I'm a member of NARIS. Here's my membership number. Enter it into the website." You just call and say, "I'm a professional in the music industry."
Wow.
Whether or not you are a member or not, and you're going to get that help. So finding ways to continue to expand that, continue to grow the way we generate money so that we can better serve the industry is something that is definitely on my priority list. And then personally, on the music side and film and TV side, my company is continuing to grow and do great projects, write great songs, hopefully make more good music. And then we're definitely involved in quite a few productions of movies and series, things like that. And I find fantastic. The opportunity now to combine music with film and TV is, I think, probably there's not been a desire like this ever, maybe in the history, because of all the different outlets and the streaming companies. And there's just a real, I think, appetite for music and film opportunities. So I think I'm uniquely positioned in the future to make sure we're providing some great content, some great art, not just content, but great art for people to enjoy and hopefully make a difference in the world.
You know, you're a hooper. Folks may not know that. And then the serendipity of you being able to produce, you know, the updated version of One Shining Moment, and you have played in the Final Four, is, you know, there's some stuff that's just Jesus, you know. And then also, you know, doing LeBron's movie. I love, you know, I'm a passionate NBA guy. And as you said earlier, there's something about our space where you can invoke and involve your passions and have it be an outlet. And that's ultimately what living is about. Everything else is just kind of working and existing. But when you can't stop yourself because you're able to do that, that's kind of, I think, the goal in life that you learn as you get a little bit older. And I got to say, man, not only are you living it, but you're sharing it and you're involving people in it and extending it across platform. It is felt, it is known. We acknowledge it, involve us, you know, our constituency. One of the things that I say about our constituency and what I love that Maureen does, in the producer and engineer side, they often don't have another umbrella around them. Artists may have labels, other kinds of things. Songwriters may have publishers. So, you know, the producer and engineer side has the producer and engineer wing and us, or we at least take some credit for it. And there's so much going on now because, as you pointed out, everything is now kind of a hybrid. You see the demand for content, and you can make music and do film and television, and producers and engineers, they now do things that all are kind of inclusive. They're somewhat songwriters and they're artists and they're other, and then you have this sort of intersection of technology in that space, which means the future is there. So it's an area, you know, that I think is ripe for attention and stuff like that. And so we're going to keep advocating and be great to work with you on that.
It'll be my pleasure. And I'm going to continue to do what I love to do at this point. Also, you asked the future for me and what I'm going to be doing going forward. And what I've really been getting a lot of satisfaction from is being able to give back, not just at the Academy, but for some reason, you know, you reach a point in your life and your career and people start calling you and asking you your advice. And I've been doing so much of that. And I love it. And I feel really thankful that people consider my opinion valuable. And so absolutely. I've been talking to a lot of producers, a lot of engineers, a lot of creators, and they just, Harvey, I just need somebody to talk to. I just have a problem or an issue or something I'm trying to figure out. So to your point, and I don't really know when you cross over, but there is that feeling of not just doing work and not just continuing to be in the rut or the grind, but to give back and to be able to help people. And I don't want to sound overly corny, but that's really where I'm getting a lot of pleasure and satisfaction and feeling like I'm finding a purpose and being able to help people and be a resource for people who are coming up for the next generation.
Harvey, did you take anything from your basketball success and you won state championships with your high school teams? I mean, your basketball career is impressive. What did you take from that journey into this new journey at Naris?
Well, I took everything from basketball into everything I do, basically, not just Naris, but my whole life, my career, my relationships, my personality. You know, I played for a Hall of Fame coach named Lute Olson, who just this year passed away, unfortunately. Yeah. He was one of my mentors and made a huge difference in my life. So my experience with him and what I learned from him and learned from the group of guys that I played with is something that totally has formed who I am as a person. One of my teammates and sometimes roommate was a guy named Steve Kerr, who played in the NBA for a long time and is now coach. And I played with some of the most incredible people in that era, in that time period. And we spent, you know, every day of our lives together for 4 or 5 years in some cases. So everything from work ethic to goal setting to focus to time management to expectations and not being content and reaching for the next level of everything you do to the competition, which is something you don't often find in musicians or creators, to wanting to be the best, to driving for, you know, the top level of everything you do. Those are just some of the things that I got from both my teammates and Coach Olson that have really affected my life. And I'm just so thankful that I was able to do that and have that in my history. You know, sports is like, you have to sacrifice, you have to bust your butt to get better. And you have to, you know, people are chasing you, people are trying to catch you, or people are trying to be better than you. And it's a very competitive environment, especially at University of Arizona, and trying to go to the Final Four, trying to get off the bench, trying to get playing time. And that is something that I absolutely use every day of my life still to this day.
The it's an interesting point, because I'm the son of a professional athlete, and what you learn about sports early on is team. It's the ultimate place of collaboration. If you don't hold up your part, it breaks the system down. You have to be committed to others, not just to yourself. And you're right, it imprints you in such a way. I know that the way I lead is based on a team concept. And if you're not doing your part, we have to address that. But I just think it's good advice for the audience that while music can feel like a solo sport, you're ultimately going to win as you put it into a collaborative kind of environment. Could be distribution, could be your songwriter partner, could be your, who knows, but you're going to do it with others. And that's a great thing socially. It's great for your mental health. It's great for your creativity. It's an important consideration. Look, man, we've gone past your half hour ethos. Hopefully we didn't waste your time here. Know that Pensado's Place is available not only to Harvey Mason Jr., but to the Grammys and Naris. At each and every turn, there's some contributions I think we could be helpful with, and happy to do it. But more importantly, excuse me, man to man, just proud of you, dude. Just straight up proud of you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Herb. It means a lot. And we've known each other for a lot of years, made records together, been through business, but I've always appreciated your friendship and support. And Dave, I have to say the same for you. You know, I grew up really idolizing you as an engineer, as a mixer. I always said, one day I'm going to have to mix some of my songs, and I got the chance to have that happen. So just really thankful for both of you. Thank you for the work you're doing, and always, always appreciate you continuing, you know, the legacy that you both have established, but also just bringing people on and sharing the information, sharing the knowledge, and especially letting me come on for my second time now onto your show. So good to do it, and look forward to doing it again, talking more.
Many more. Dave, why don't you wrap us up?
Man, I was really struck by the way he had talked about athletics. And Herb, you know really well because of your dad. I'm going to rethink a lot of things about my life, seriously, from talking with Harvey today. And I'm not going to do the 6 a.m. thing, but everything else I'm going to try to do, Harvey. Thanks for sharing it. We'll see you guys next time.